becomes exactly half, and the 30 million requirement that I projected may become around 17 to 18 million.
You may have partly answered that my question right there, but out of this total amount of capital you need, roughly what proportion do you figure has to be something other than pure investment? I mean, does any of this have to be either subsidies or technical assistance on an ongoing basis?
The figure that I mentioned here is a combination of equity and debt, and we would also equity and debt as well as PPP subsidies. So it's a combination of all three. In terms of subsidy, we are looking at around 25% subsidy as and when the government partners with us. So that leaves aside around the ask being around 22 million. Out of that, we are looking for around 8 million as equity and balance as debt. And technical assistance, of course, is welcome.
So if I can slip in a second quick question here. To what extent do you figure you've actually established the individual economics? In other words, your model seems based on the idea that individuals will pay at least a little bit extra to get away from the quacks, as you call it, or the informal system. Is that actually, have you got a kind of record that shows that's the case, that people will pay a little, especially poor people, will and can pay more for a somewhat better service?
Before we started this model, we did survey across two different Indian states in terms of the prices being charged by the informal health providers or local practitioners or quacks. And the prices ranged from anything between 20 rupees to 90 rupees, depending upon which state that state was. So in those terms, I would say that the price point we are charging, 20 rupees and 30 rupees, is on the lower end of what they charge as of now in Punjab. So to that extent, the community is willingly, comfortably able to pay for such price for consultations.
Yeah, Amit, the people who are coming to your EHPs, what percentage of those patients or people you are able to serve completely? As in, I want to understand how much of that is referred to a next level of health point, maybe to the next district.
So to that extent, more than around 85% of people are being served at the primary healthcare level, as we see. And 1 out of 6 persons generally requires a referral. And within that, we referral to the secondary, and maybe tertiary care. And out of that, we give them a choice for being referred either to a private sector or a public sector. So it's like 1 out of 6, 1 out of 7. It's means we are yet to see the last quarter's percentage. Till December 2000, it was like 1 out of 6.
Out of that 1 out of 6, what are the top three conditions?
Out of 1 out of 6, the top three conditions, one is that, you know, people generally, you know, they have like cases where the gastroenteritis has actually turned into ulcers. And this is largely seen for, you know, basically for women in the villages. For male patients, it has been seen as cardiovascular, starting with a chest pain complaint, generally in 35 years and above. And the second one is arthritis, which is common across male and female both. And arthritis kind of, you know, then resulting into, you know, deformed limbs and all, and maybe requiring a secondary intervention. Other than that, for children, we are getting cases like acute respiratory, you know, tract infections, ARIs, mostly in winter season. And then, of course, there is fluorosis, but then that doesn't have a cure. So water is the only cure as of now, clean water. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Samir, and I'm going to present about neurosynaptic communications. A brief executive summary, but I think I will cover the presentation first since we have limited time. We are in the business of enabling access to quality healthcare for the rural and remote population. And first of all, I would like to thank Amit for making a very good case for the rural healthcare and the divide, as well as very clearly defining that any of the bridges that can be built for this divide would involve technology in it. May it be diagnostics, may it be related to the teleconsultations, or even planning of the whole networks and so on. So our primary thrust is to provide an end-to-end solution through partners, and technology is our key differentiator. The promoters come with a strong background, academic background, and a large experience, industry experience. we address the rural e-healthcare delivery for the sectors of NGO, the government, as well as hospital outreach and even overseas at this point of time with our business models. We do this through our patented remedy technology, which is developed indigenously and with extensive insights into the rural healthcare domain through various of our partners. And our focus is on, and this is the distinguishing factor from many of the other e-healthcare solution providers or so-called telemedicine providers, is that we focus on integration of healthcare delivery processes into technology, making a successful e-healthcare platform. And I'll come to why I call that. I will not make the case for the need for healthcare delivery anymore, except that the situation here is changing, as Amit had mentioned. And anything that is relating to rural healthcare delivery would involve a high amount of technology along with the implementation. We assess the total addressable healthcare market for neurosynaptic as about $4 billion worldwide at this point of time, of which close to $1 billion we estimate in India with the present business models. The technology, basically the remedy platform that we have, brings together various ecosystem partners in the healthcare delivery, in the e-healthcare delivery, and ties them with the various workflows that are necessary for such healthcare deliveries to be effectively provided to the last mile. This platform, and I would rather not compare remedy with the telemedicine or those kind of solutions, but more like ERP kind of solutions where a whole healthcare delivery is mapped and the processes are mapped and made effectively matching to the actual healthcare delivery processes in the field. And so essentially that's where this this solution is. We have a technology which is indigenously developed, of course, medical devices. There are innovations at various levels in the technology. The first level being the devices and the software itself, where the devices that we have developed work on very minimum power. As long as your computer or laptop is on, your device is also on. It works on 32 kilobits per second kind of connectivities, which are available even through the normal landlines. And of course, since it is indigenously developed, it breaks many cost barriers that have been there with the existing devices and so on. But where we differentiate, there is also a differentiation in the way the technology is built, such that it closely resembles the ERP kind of a thing rather than a telemedic or teleconsultation kind of a thing, which is very limited in its scope and does not cover many processes. However, what is the real differentiation is that we focus on integrating the healthcare delivery ecosystem as a whole, and we look at entire delivery system in terms of a project rather than retailing out the product or retailing out the solutions. We work with the partners to understand the delivery processes and customize the workflows accordingly to match the ground level. We focus on working with existing infrastructure and skill set. The whole solution is built such that it can be used by the regular workers, health workers that we find in the remote rural villages of population 1,000, 5,000 and those levels. And of course the platform is ruggedized with heavy utilization now on the field, with more than 700 units already being shipped to various partners. Frugal engineering, of course, whatever is required, we call this appropriate technology. We do not like to include anything that does not make sense at the ground level, and we have always operated since the beginning of the company with this philosophy. We believe that has given us the successes that we have seen. The platform has seen more than 100,000 consultations in the last year alone with a variety of partners. This was with about 120, 130 centers that were operational last year, which have now grown to 700 plus centers being deployed. This would cover about a crore or 10 million population, if I may say that. I think that's okay. So about 1 crore population. What is the value proposition for patients and partners? For our patients, and we get a very cost-effective reach to patients for our partner. We have efficient end-to-end healthcare delivery. disease profiling and management. So it's just not the consultation, but it takes care of your medicine inventory mapping, the consumption of medicines, the epidemiology, where are the diseases originating, almost all of the management reports that are required to manage a large-scale healthcare network on the field. In addition to putting a lot of checks and balances, getting feedbacks about the sessions, quality audits, integration with the CRMs, and all sorts of things. For the patients, this is an access at the cost of less than US dollar. And we have about 75 to 85% of patients not requiring to go to the next level of care. Consequently, a lot of travel and unnecessary expenses saved for the patients. On any day, out of the 10 patients that the center sees, 4 patients have come to the center for their different ailment next time, which means there is a very high acceptability of the whole solution. And so essentially, those are the parameters that we define the success of the platform with. We work on 4 segments, as I said. Different segments have different models of delivery as well as different models of revenue and investments. So I would not be really able to pan out here what are those, but for the sake of example, I have taken 2 of those sectors that we work with. In the government, we basically work in partnership with local players and large e-governance and PPP players. We build up turnkey projects rather than doing the sale of equipment or trying to push the equipment into the given system. We build turnkey projects through investments into POCs in the identified geographies of strengths, which depend on the partners that we have and the needs that we have. We have presently, just a minute, we have about 7 entities whom we are working with right now. We are working in 3 states with different POCs or the business development that is going on. And we plan to add 6 more states. We already have district-wide orders for these to be implemented in the government networks, which is a significant achievement against the backdrop of a lot of failures of the earlier so-called telemedicine solutions, which had been technology pushed. The management team, Rajiv and I come from very similar background of the Indian Institute of Science. We completed our graduation there. We worked at Motorola for quite some time and then decided to start this company. As about 7 years of experience, most of it spent on the field trying to understand and experiment with various business models that failed, did not work adequately, effectively, and consequently designing or redesigning the solutions and redefining the roles of partners and so on. Mr. Khemchandra Birade, the Vice President of Business Development, has experimented in large-scale government networks. He's handled government, the driving license today that we see in the Maharashtra state has been the scheme implemented by him statewide, which was a $100 million project. We have a prolific advisory board in Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala and Dr. K. Vijay Raghavan of NCBS. And I would like to just mention one thing here, that we have also been selected earlier for as a technology pioneer by the World Economic Forum in 2008 for the healthcare space. We have just started growing. We have done about 3 times revenue in the Remedy product since last year. And we plan to continue the growth the same way. There is a very large and very significantly advanced pipeline that the company today has in both the government sector as well as the overseas market sector. And we plan to realize those in this year and coming year.